and today is Thanksgiving Sunday. I am super excited. Are you ready for praise and worship? You don't even have a choice. You have to be ready for praise and worship because we need to praise God. It is amazing to praise the Lord. Can you put on your dancing shoes? Your dancing shoes should be on, okay? I have mine here. Are you ready? Okay, put your hands together and close your eyes. Lord, we thank you and we glorify your name. We thank you because you are amazing. You are a good Father. Lord, even as we praise you, even as we worship you, we ask that you come and dwell in our presence and you help us to praise and worship you as we ought to, in the name of Jesus.
I'm overwhelmed. that's all I need. I humble all I am, all to you. One way, Jesus, you're the only one that I could live for. One way, Jesus, you're the only one that I could live for. You're the only one, you're the only one. You're the only one that I could live for. You're the only one, you're the only one. You're the only one that I could live for. You were always, always there. Everyhow and everywhere. It breaks a bell so deeply within me. You will never, ever change. Yesterday, today,
afraid to shout. So come on and lift your hands.
Concentrate and worship the living God. You can raise your hands up, you can kneel down, whatever you want to do, just ensure that you are worshiping the living God. All right. Good Father, mighty Father, Lord, even as we go to learn at your feet, we ask that you help us listen, help us to understand, help us to learn at your feet, O God, in Jesus' name. We pray, most heavenly Father, that we'll not just hear these words, but help us to do your word in the name of Jesus. Thank you, Abba Father, Lord, for in Jesus' amazing name we have prayed. Amen.
Good morning, good morning, good morning to you, good morning to you, good morning to you, and of course, good morning to you. It's another amazing Sunday, and we are here for such a wonderful Sunday worship experience. I hope you danced during the praise and worship, and I hope you sang very loudly. Why? Because praises loud. Yes, 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 yes. It's good to see you today. You know we are C-Rock. And what does C-Rock mean? Children reaching others for Christ's kingdom. So yes, we are the children's church of God's favorite house. The best church in the whole world. Yes, it is. Now, how are you doing today? How has the holiday been coming up? Have you been having fun throughout the summer holiday? Have you been helping mommy and daddy with their chores? And are you getting set for the C-Rock Summer Camp? camp. Yes, the Syrah summer camp is coming up and it promises to be loads and loads of fun. So get ready because we are all coming here to rejoice in the Lord and to have a great and a godly experience. Now it's time for us to say our good mornings. So turn to your neighbor and say good morning. Now turn to your other neighbor and say good morning. And then what do you do next? Wave your hands and say good morning, good morning, yes, yes. Oh, good morning, I see you. You look good, by the way. Oh, I see you too. Good morning to you too. Good, good. Now it's time for us to check our five items. So let's bring out our files, all neatly packed up, and let's go through our five items. Your notebook, your pen or your pencil, your fresh fire, your Bible, and your offering. Amazing. You have all of yours? Ooh, you're ready. You have yours? Okay. Now let's start to study the Word of God. Who remembers what last month's topic was? Today's a new month. Oh, it's Thanksgiving Sunday. No wonder you were dancing so much. Yes, we're going to dance and give thanks to the Almighty God. It's another amazing Thanksgiving Sunday. Wow, we've had January, February, March, April, May, June, July, and we're already in August. Ooh, seems just like yesterday we said Happy New Year. Ooh, God is amazing, isn't he? Well, who remembers last month's topic? Last month's topic was new streams. Yes, yes, yes. And who remembers what the first week was all about? New streams, newness. And we said our Heavenly Father doesn't get tired of adding value to us every new day, new month, new week, new year. Ooh, new, new, new. God always has something new in store for us. And in week two, we said it was new streams. What to expect? What do we expect from God? New streams of colors. Yes, God will robe us in brilliant colors. What else? What else? New streams of peace. Yes, we said in any way we have in trouble, God will give us peace. What's the next one? New streams of opportunities, that God will open doors no man can shut. And the final one, new streams of life. We said that God will keep breathing new streams of life into us and we will bloom, we will blossom, and we will flourish. So what did we learn in the third week? We learned new streams, barriers. And we said some things like to act as a barrier or block, you know, the direction we are going to our new streams, like a dam. You know, we said that a dam is what obstructs the flow of water. Yes, and we said these barriers could be what? Worries and wounds. But that the good thing is that once we let go of our worries and our past wounds and hand over our lives in authority to God, he will heal us, he will break every barrier, and he will release our daily, monthly, yearly new streams to us. Ooh, you paid so much attention last month. I'm so, so proud of you. Now, today being a new day and the first Sunday in the month of August, we have a new topic. And the topic is create. Yes. So today's topic is create in his image. Let's say it together. One, two, go. Create in his image. So create is the ability to merge the practical and the imaginary. So we think of something imaginary and we think about it and we merge it with the practical, just like faith, and we create something. Now God introduces himself to us as number one creator in Genesis. Numero uno. Yes. Now when we go to Genesis 1, 1 and 3, it says, are we there? Let's open it. In the beginning, God created the sky and the earth. God said, let there be light. And there was light. Now do you notice the first thing that our God created? What was it? It was light. Let there be light, and there was light. Have you ever wondered why? Why light? Why did God create light when he already could see everything? Because he's God, all-seeing, all-knowing, so he could see everything. Why do you think the first thing He created was light. See, God has called us to be co-creators with Him. Remember, the Bible says that I can do all things through Christ who gives us the strength. So we are called to be co-creators with God, and He has given us those tools that we need to create. Yes, He has. He has blessed us abundantly with those tools. Oh, I hear you asking, what are the tools? Well, let's look at three. The first one is the Word of God. Read your Bible, pray every day.
Pray every day, pray every day. Read your Bible and pray every day if you want to grow. If you want to grow, if you want to grow. Read your Bible and pray every day if you want to grow. If you don't read your Bible, forget to pray. If you don't read your Bible and forget to pray, oh, you will not grow. Oh, you will not grow. Oh, you will not grow. If you don't read your Bible and forget to pray, oh, you will not grow.
Powerful tool. Nothing beats the Word of God. The Word of God is life. God said, let there be light. Word of God. So the Word of God is so powerful. If we read Hebrews 11:3, let's go there. It says that the whole world was made by God's command. This means that what we see was made by something that cannot be seen. The whole world was created just by a command of God. Now, what is the Word of God for that area of your life that you deserve a break or change? What is it? Think. There's somewhere you want God to come and answer you. Locate it and speak it. Find it and speak it. The second one is the mind must be engaged. So, you know, we said that we think about things, we locate it, and we speak it. That's the mind, right? Now, we're saying that that mind that we have, the mind, must be engaged. It must be sharp and positive. So, the second one is the mind must be engaged, sharp, and positive. Now, a sad or unhappy mind cannot be creative. Sometimes we want to create things. We find ourselves sad. We really can't create much because we need to rejoice. Again, I say rejoice. Now, let's go to Nehemiah chapter 4, verse 6. It says, the people were willing to work hard. Now, this tells us only one thing. You must be willing to work hard, really hard. Now, the third one is the tongue. Your tongue. Life and death is in the power of the tongue. Where did I hear that? Okay, let's open Proverbs 18:21. Are we there? It says that what you say can mean life or death. What you say can bring life or death. Always remember that. The safest thing is to say what the Word of God says. That's safe. Nothing is safer than that. Stay in the place of God. Believe in the word of God. Trust in the word of God. And you can do all things through Christ who gives you the strength. You can create. Yes, it's all in God. Stay in God. Believe in God. Believe that God can do all things. And what happens? Because the word of God is life, you will create. Praise the Lord. Hallelujah. So what did we learn today? Let's see if you were paying attention. We learned that, tell me. We learned that to create is the ability to merge the practical and the imaginary. Yes. And, you know, when we studied the Bible, we saw that God introduces himself to us as the number one, because in the beginning, God created the sky and the earth. And he said something. What did he say? Let there be light. And we said that that's the first thing God created. Why? Because that will teach us that creativity starts with light, illumination, or an idea. Great. We always need to remember that we cannot go where we cannot see. And because God is great, he gave us tools for creation. The first one is the word of God. The second one is that the mind must be engaged, the mind must be sharp, and the mind must be positive. And what's the third one? The tongue, yes. Now, whatever we say can mean life or death, because the power to life or death is in our tongue. So the safest thing to say is what the word of God says. Fantastic. I see you were paying attention. Now, if we go to the second page, we see the story of Bezalel. Yes, Bezalel. Oh, you haven't heard about Bezalel? Well, in Exodus 31, God specifically picked a man called Bezalel to do a special creative work for him. God just pick me or pick you to do a special creative work for him. Yes, he will, because we are amazing. We are filled with the life of Christ Jesus. We're listening to our destinies, taking the world for him.
It was time to construct the tabernacle, just as God had told Moses on Mount Sinai. Moses explained everything they had to do to the Israelites. This is what God has ordered. Take from your belongings an offering for God. With generosity in your heart, bring God gold, silver, bronze, precious stones, skins, and fabrics. Moses also told them they would need agile men and women who knew of carpentry, crafts, weaving, and embroidery. For this construction, there would be two people in charge. Look, people of Israel, said Moses. Jehovah has named Bezalel, grandson of Hur, from the tribe of Judah.
It's my grandson.
And he has filled him with the Holy Spirit, with wisdom, intelligence, and creative capability to do the artistic work on gold, silver, bronze, and precious stones. He has also chosen Aholiab from the tribe of Dan, who he has filled with wisdom to make all kinds of crafts and designs on all the fabrics. And so, Bezalel and Aholiab carried out the work for the tabernacle, just as God had ordered, together with the people who had the same artistic spirit, and to whom God had given the ability to carry out the work. The Israelites brought many offerings. They brought gold, silver, bronze, precious stones, skins, and cloth for the tabernacle. Day after day, the people kept bringing more and more offerings. More than was needed. So, Moses had to tell them that enough was enough, and not to bring any more. Thus, the Israelites stopped bringing offerings. And so, the construction of the tabernacle began exactly as God had requested. Inside the tent, they divided it into two parts. One they called the Holy of Holies. There, they placed the Ark of the Covenant, which had the commandments inside. The other part they called the Holy Place, which is where they placed a table of bread, a candlestick of pure gold, and an altar of incense. Outside the tent, they built and placed the altar of burnt offerings, where sacrifices and offerings would be made to God, a bronze fountain, and an atrium at the entrance of the tent. And like that, they built the tabernacle. It was also called the sanctuary, which in Hebrew is Mishkan, which means dwelling. God had chosen Aaron as the high priest of Israel, and his sons as priests. They were the ones who were going to represent God before the Israelites, as well as coordinate the worship of God and the sacrifices or offerings. A special garment was prepared for them. Aaron, as the high priest, wore a pectoral, which had 12 precious stones. Each one of them had the name of the 12 tribes of Israel engraved. On the turban, he had a plate of pure gold, which was engraved, Holiness to Jehovah. Finally, the tabernacle was complete. Moses inspected the work and saw that everything was exactly as God had wanted.
Yay!
And at that instant, the cloud of God covered the tabernacle, and the glory of God was manifested there. Moses could not enter the tabernacle because the cloud prevented him from doing so, and the glory of God filled the entire sanctuary. Whenever the cloud moved from the tabernacle, the Israelites were to leave camp and follow the cloud. But when the cloud stayed in the same place, the Israelites were also to stay, just as it was in the desert. God called Moses from the tent, giving him instructions on what to do in the tabernacle. God wanted the people of Israel to be holy. Holy means to be set apart, or set apart for a purpose. God wanted the Israelites to turn away from sin to live among themselves. Since sin kept them away from God and brought death. And since God is holy and pure, any impurity, even the smallest, would drop dead in the presence of God. And so, for the people to be free of sin and impurity, God explained how to become holy through 5 types of sacrifices or rituals. 2 of them were a way for the Israelites to thank God for what he had given them before, offering him a gift from their harvest or livestock. The other 3 sacrifices were a way to ask God for forgiveness. When an Israelite sinned, he had to offer the blood of an animal so that it would die in his place. The Israelite who committed the sin had to put his hand on the head of the animal and symbolically pass on the sin he had committed. Then, the animal would have the sin, and that is why it had to be sacrificed and burned on the altar of holocausts.
Oh my God!
They would bring calves, lambs, goats, oxen, and doves. But all the offerings they brought had to be without flaws. Then, Aaron and his sons were consecrated by Moses to be in the presence of God in the tabernacle. God, through Moses, told them what was required to be a priest. the priests had to remain holy because they represented the people before God, but they also represented God before the people. At one point, two of Aaron's sons, Nadab and Abihu, casually walked into God's presence. Each carrying his censer, and offered God a fire that he had not commanded. Immediately, a fire from God consumed them both. And they died. God is pure goodness, but becomes dangerous for those who insult his holiness. And there, they understood that it was important that the priests should remain holy. Later, God provided instructions for the people of Israel so they could be pure and holy. One of the instructions was about which clean animals could be eaten and which animals were impure and should not be eaten. He also provided instruction on which festivals should be celebrated once a year. One was called the Day of Atonement, a day when the high priest asks for forgiveness for all the Israelites. For that, he took two male goats. One of the goats would be an offering of purification for the people. The other goat was called the scapegoat. The priest would confess Israel's sins, symbolically lay his hands on this goat, and it would then be sent to the desert, so that Israel's sins would be washed away. This way, God would be able to live in peace with the people. God provided many more instructions. Moses concluded by telling the people that if they could obey and follow the commandments, they would be blessed. However, if they disobeyed, they wouldn't be able to enter the promised land that was promised to Abraham.
People of Israel, be obedient.
Now, can you guess what the key to Bezalel's creativity was? Well, if you said the Holy Spirit, boom, you are correct. Now, God filled Bezalel with his spirit and by the power of the Holy Spirit. You see, Bezalel had a skill. He had skill, he had ability, and he had knowledge to do God's special work. And God is happy to fill his children with the Spirit. All we have to do is ask. Yes, we just have to ask and we'll be just like Bezalel. God will use us to do his creative work. Now, if we look at Luke 11:13, it says, surely your heavenly Father knows how to give the Holy Spirit to those who ask him. God's Spirit gives us the gifts, skills, ability, and knowledge to create, just like our Father God. We are co-creators with God, and we are empowered by the Holy Spirit. Praise, praise, praise the Lord. Aha, hallelujah. Have you been reading your Bible? You know, I was telling you to read your Bible every day. Now, this week, we have Bible passages ready for you to study. On Monday, we have Genesis 1:27. On Tuesday, we have Psalm 33, 6, and 9. On Wednesday, we have Exodus 31, 2 to 5. On Thursday, we have Exodus 35, 30 to 35. On Friday, we have 1 Corinthians 2, 16. And on Saturday, we have Philippians 4, 13. Then, like we always do on Sunday, we'll come together and study the Word of God. Remember that anyone you do, you tick, done, 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 done. Yes, because we'll check that you are studying. Well, it's time for us to take our life applications. Let's all stand up, put your right hand where? On your chest and repeat after me. I am made in God's image. I am filled with God's Spirit. I have the skill, ability, and knowledge to create. Now let's take this again. I am made in God's image. I am filled with God's Spirit. I have the skill, ability, and knowledge to create. Yes, we all do. Now sit down and let's learn our memory verse for the month of August. Sit down. Our memory verse is taken from Exodus chapter 31, verse 3, and it says, I have filled Bezalel with the Spirit of God. I have given him the skill, ability, and knowledge to do all kinds of work. Now let's take this again. Our memory verse is taken from Exodus chapter 31, verse 3, and it says, I have filled Bezalel with the Spirit of God. I have given him the skill, ability, and knowledge to do all kinds of work. Great, great. Well, it's time for us to go. But before we go, you know we'll pray, and then we'll check our hygiene. So now let us pray. All heads bowed, all eyes closed. We want to pray. Close your eyes. Put your hands together and let's say our prayers. Say, Father, fill me with your creative spirit, the Holy Spirit, and with your light. In Jesus' name, amen. In Jesus' name, amen. Now let's check our hygiene. We're all going to sing the song together. So now let's do it together. One, two, go. Wash your hands, clean, clean, clean. Wash your hands, clean, clean, clean. Wash your hands for how long? 20 seconds. Use your sanitizers and your face masks. Remember, when you want to cough, we don't cough. How do we cough? Let's do this together. We cough. And then finally, don't touch dirty surfaces. So for me to you, till next time, it's bye-bye.